Well, good morning. First of all, it's a pleasure to be here. As Brent said, first of all, you're probably wondering if, when you saw Tony Bennett was speaking. There were some of you who would probably wondered whether I was going to like do a few bars if I left my heart in San Francisco. For you older folks with gray in your hair, and then like you sports fanatics, I know that table back there was talking about sports earlier. You thought I was going to talk maybe about what won the Cavaliers the national championship last year, right? And a little background: I am a former high school basketball coach in Indiana. Spent 10 years. I was very fortunate. I had all the ingredients that good coaches have. I had good players. And I have often said in Indiana, that's actually how I got to be elected state superintendent. That's actually how I went from a classroom teacher to a principal to a district superintendent to being elected, is I had a successful high school basketball coaching career. So Hoosiers, the movie, is real. What I would like to do this morning is maybe talk to you a little bit about the last 10 years in education, because it has been, I would refer to it as cyclical, a great example of cycles in education and pendulum swings. And it reflects the environment in which you work, because many of you are dealing with districts who are still living in that 10 years ago paradigm, implementing things that were the result of big policy initiatives in your state 10 years ago. And some of you are now much past that. So I kind of want to cover that whole thing, and then we're going to talk about how that affects your business and how we can capitalize on that. Because I want you to know, I'm an educator. My wife is a district superintendent in Indiana. My daughter is a middle school assistant principal in Indiana. So we're an education family, but I'm a capitalist pig. So I am very much into kind of free market work in education. And we'll talk a little bit about that. So I'm gonna really talk about what happened, what next, and what are the opportunities. As Brent mentioned, I now work for K-12, the nation's largest provider of virtual education in America. I really oversee the performance of schools. That's my job. Been with them since November, actually. I consulted with them for 3 years, and basically they asked me to come in-house and do it. So let's start with a little walk down memory lane. A time near and dear to my heart. Education reform was in vogue. I want you to think about that. Think about if you were in this business in 2010. I'm just going to ask you, what were some of the things you heard about all across the nation around that time? Teaching, well, that's more later, but yes. What else? What? Anybody remember Race to the Top? A whole bunch of money that the federal government put out to bribe states and school districts into changing? Not a bad idea. Remember those nasty words, Common Core State Standards? Accountability. Somebody mentioned teaching to the test. That was kind of the response to accountability, and we're going to get into that. Educational choice. How many of you now work in states where there is vast choice in education in terms of where kids can go? That's a big opportunity for you, by the way. We're going to talk about that. So what happened in this kind of three-year window? States made huge changes, massive changes. And what happened? Let's go back. Secretary Duncan, President Obama rolled out Race to the Top. They basically said, states, if you want a big hunk of this money, you've got to do X, Y, and Z. And if you do X, Y, and Z, you can compete for these big chunks of money to reform education in your state. And many states passed sweeping policy initiatives to facilitate that. Many. Matter of fact, And I'm going to talk about Indiana here in a minute. Indiana, and I'm not going to be political here, I'm going to be very generic, but Indiana, if you look on either CNN or Fox News or MSNBC, the kind of the spectrum of media, Indiana's a red state. And we used policies promoted by President Obama and Secretary Duncan to drive our agenda between 2010 and 2013. We went out and we tell legislators, especially those who were not on our side of the aisle, but were more closely tied to the president and secretary, well, what are you guys upset about? This is your guys' stuff. So a lot of states were doing that. Florida, Arizona, Tennessee, historic red states were capitalizing because the federal government, being completely of the opposite political ilk, were supporting educational initiatives that more closely resembled what conservatives thought at the time. So a big opportunity in America for this thing we called education reform. I think the biggest thing I want you to take away is that last line. Education reform was referred to as student-centered. I want you to think about that, student-centered. Every state, go to Idaho, go to Indiana, go to Arizona, go to Florida, all of them had like big agendas in this time, and they were referred to as putting students first, putting children first, education first. That was the title of their agenda. And the reformers kind of owned the narrative. And so we were out there, and I'm gonna throw myself in that mix, and you'll see why in a minute. We were basically telling everybody, if you don't agree with us, you're just not for kids. And we really boxed our opponents in. So in, you know, this will unquestionably, 5 years from now, if I'm ever asked to do this presentation again, this will be the onset of the older I get, the better I was story. Because this was, in this era, the grand age of education reform. A lot of stuff happened across the country. And I am going to start with our state as a case study. And some of this you guys are going to love. So please do not put any of this through through the lens of politics. Some of it might repulse you because just it's bad, you don't think it's good policy. I don't care. This will give you an idea what happened in this time. One state. So in 2011, right in the middle of that window, we rolled out a big legislative agenda. Big, big legislative agenda. It had five major bills in it. See the first one? School vouchers. Biggest school voucher program in America. As a matter of fact, if you go to Indiana, you can send your kids to a faith-based school, you can send your kids to a charter school, or you can move your child from one school district to the other, and it's all kind of free market enterprise. My wife is a district superintendent. She actually runs school buses into her neighboring district and picks kids up and brings them to her school because we pay for the kid. That's the only way schools have money, is more kids. So it's very much free market. Vouchers were a big part of that. Charters, more charter authorizers. Teacher evaluation and compensation reform. If you were in Tennessee, that was a big deal. If you were in most states, that was a big deal. We went through massive collective bargaining reform. Now, we allowed collective bargaining, but we didn't allow it for anything more than wages and wage-related benefits. Some states, Wisconsin, did away with public collective bargaining. We did not. We said teachers are allowed to collectively bargain. We gave them a window of 2 months to get their contracts done, or it was last best offer and it was the end of the day. So we went from having work slowdowns between November and May to by the 1st of December, all collective bargaining agreements were finished and we didn't have to worry about that anymore. That was just the 2011 session. Plus we had this thing called the Mitch Daniels Scholarship. Our governor, now the president of Purdue University, Basically, what this did was if a kid wanted to graduate after 3 years, they took half of the student support with them to their post-secondary endeavor, and the school district got to keep the other half. Okay, because we knew if you're paying by the head, you didn't want to make it a disincentive for school districts to move kids on. But that's 2011. The rest of this is 2009 through 13. Take a look at that. The one that step that actually most people, especially when I speak to groups like yours, love the most, believe it or not, is the definition of a textbook. Indiana was the first state in America, February of 2009. We went to the State Board of Education and we defined a textbook to include laptop computers. We were the first state in America to do that. So school districts all over the state could use textbook adoption money to buy laptops for kids in a one-on-one environment. And that really proliferated the use of technology in our state in a big way. Other things, we revamped teacher certification, we put A through F grades on schools, made sure third graders could read at level before we passed them on to fourth grade. A little bit of controversy there. I mentioned public school choice, we offered online AP, we offered virtual schools. Those of you who, if you've never worked in the new tech or PLTW environments, big scale there. And we took over failing schools in the state. We actually yanked failing schools away from their districts and handed them to private operators and said, the school districts have screwed them up long enough, we'll give you a chance. All of this was 2009 through 13. And to be quite blunt with you, if you get on Google, you'll see it got me unelected. It was pretty abrupt. 2013 to 2016, I referred to it as pause. And that by that, and I say this not in a political way, but the education establishment fought back. They won the narrative then. To your point, it became about teaching to the test. That's when that message really dug in and got a hold of what we were trying to do. So then the narrative became education reform is anti-public education. So think about that. We went from education reform being pro-student to now if you were a reformer, you're anti-public education. And there is not a political poll I have seen, there is not a non-political public opinion poll I have seen that would tell you anything other than the fact that the most valued voice a parent has is the voice of their teacher. So when teachers started saying to parents, all this stuff they were doing between 9 and 13, it's keeping me from doing a good job with your child, the communities began to buy into this. Whereas 9 through 13, communities were saying, well, heck yeah, teachers should be held accountable. Heck yeah, they should be paid on what their kids learn. That's how I get paid. Then all of a sudden it was, wait a minute, these guys are trying to hurt our public school teachers. And they don't like our public schools. So they began to grab the narrative. Another weird thing happened, and I mentioned Common Core. The extreme right and the extreme left agreed on Common Core. I've often said the extreme left doesn't like standards and the extreme right doesn't like national. So all of a sudden, everyone kept saying, whoa, whoa, we don't want these Common Core things because those are national standards. And if you were right of center, you didn't want national. And if you were left of center, you really didn't want the testing and accountability piece. And so they agreed. In states like Indiana that had a conservative governor who signed on to Common Core, it got tanked. And I'm going to talk about sustainability in a minute because that's a big part of your business. The other thing was overreach. Federal overreach in this case. Race to the top became a very dirty term because it represented overreach by the federal government into state and local responsibility. And We were blamed for teacher shortages, and most of us were filtered out. As I mentioned, in November 2012, I was voted out of office, had to go to Florida and pick up down there for a while. My friends in Louisiana, Paul Pastorek, if any of you are here from Louisiana, it was about the time Paul Pastorek went out, Chris Cerf went out in New Jersey, Kevin Huffman went out in Tennessee. Folks who did the work we were doing, if you were in Oklahoma, Janet Barisi got beaten very badly in Oklahoma. We were all kind of pushed out during this time. And now we kind of bring ourselves to the most recent history. And that is the fact that states' rights are now re-emerging. Listen to the State of the Union address. Regardless of how you feel about the president, listen to the State of the Union address. Was there anything in there that gave you any impression whatsoever that the state that the federal government is going to deal with anything other than trying to find a way to fund school choice? If you hit the rewind button and listen to President Obama's 2009, 2010, 2011 State of the Union speeches, you will hear education being a big component of those. But now we have gone back to education is a state and local responsibility. And we lost that for a number of years. We're back to 50 different tests. 50 different sets of accountability standards, 50 different sets of standards, albeit Common Core was successful, that most of them are now higher. So we are back into, you have to work in the states where you work, as opposed to looking at these common threads that emerged between 2009 and 2013. And now we define education reform as protecting our turf. You know, in my home state of Indiana, all we care about now is making sure that they don't kill the voucher program, making sure we have robust school choice, making sure that we keep a third grade reading law because it drove our NAEP scores way up. We are defending ourselves. And that's kind of where we are today. So we have seen this huge pendulum swing from big nationally based policies that led the dialogue in 2010, 2009 and 2010, to today where it's all about what is being done in local districts, local schools, and in states. And in the middle, we had the fight over turf. Does that make sense? Now, you might say, what's that have to do with my business? Let me go back. How do I go back? There we go. If you were in this, you really had a good set of rules to go by. Go back to the four pillars of Race to the Top. Great teachers and leaders, turning around our lowest performing schools, high sets of standards, and strong use of data and data systems. Those are the four pillars of Race to the Top. And as a matter of fact, when you filled out your Race to the Top application, those were the four things you had to talk about that you were going to do in your state. So if you were working in states that were pursuing Race to the Top application, specifically Tennessee, Florida, Louisiana, Arizona, Delaware, we dropped out very early and just said we're not going to do it anymore because I couldn't frankly get our teachers union to buy in, and that was a big part of the scoring, and I just said, well, if we can't get our teachers union to buy in and that's how you win, I guess we're out. But we took our Race to the Top early application, and that became our 2011 legislative agenda. So we just said, look, we're not going to take the money. We'll just do the work anyway. But back then, you knew the rules. And you could take solutions to different states that looked similar because there was a common thread among your states. You could go to Louisiana, to Tennessee, to Indiana, to Florida, to New Jersey, and you knew they were all speaking the same language. and it was generally around race to the top. You get here, you've got to know your local district and you've got to know your state environment. Much, much more in depth than you did back then. And I'm going to talk about knowing your state environment because I believe that's a place, and Brent and I were talking, that's a place where I believe you can really fill some gaps in your business. So let's talk about this kind of looking forward. What are the big bets? What are the big bets in education as I see them? And there's one I didn't put on here because it's frankly so obvious, I just didn't. And the other thing is I ran out of room for little check marks. School safety. If I were you, be betting on school safety. Poll 100 parents today, and 72% of them on the average will tell you they choose the school they choose because they believe their child is safe. It's a big dog deal. School safety is important. So I want to stay on choice a little bit because there's a key theme there for you. If you haven't been paying attention, I think in June we're going to see a Supreme Court decision come out of a Montana case regarding the Montana Blaine Amendment. If you're not familiar with Blaine Amendments, they are amendments in state constitutions that prohibit state funds from being used in faith-based schools in the form of vouchers. If the Supreme Court overturns Blaine in Montana, there will likely be a domino effect across the country, and you will begin to see more and more voucher tax, scholarship tax credit programs and educational savings accounts scaled across the country. And that's going to be a big, big opportunity for you. Plus, it forces public schools to compete. So things like customer service, marketing, personalized learning, driving revenues, those all become really important to public school districts today. And they weren't before. A number of states used to have guaranteed funding formulas. Some states called, they had the, what was commonly called the 2% minimum guarantee. So your funding as a district would always go up 2% regardless. Many of those states have gutted that, and now you're just funded on per pupil. So guess what? If you're a district superintendent, you can no longer run your district just by controlling costs. You got to control costs and increase revenues. And how do you increase revenues? You attract students. How do you attract students? You engage in innovative practices that tell parents our school district's better than our next door neighbor. And your business can help them do that. And you should frame that every time you go in. If you're working in Indiana, do we have anybody here from Indiana? Am I right?
Actually, just reading about Hamilton Heights. Taking students in from Westville, Mobileville, Carmel, and how it's a funding model.
Exactly. Hamilton Heights is a smaller district outside the very affluent northeastern suburb of Indianapolis, and they flourish financially by attracting kids out of those large urban or suburban high-performing districts where maybe their kids don't feel like they belong there. In my wife's school district in Clarksville, right across the bridge from Louisville, Kentucky, it's the smallest district in what we refer to as the Fall Cities. 30% of her children come from out of the district. 30%. She has a district of about 1,500 kids. Her district is funded at about $6,700 a kid. So take 1,500, 30% of 1,500. Take that times $6,500, $6,700, and you see how important that becomes. So you have the opportunity to go into states where there is wide choice, and you have the opportunity to sit down with a superintendent, a business manager, it probably permeates every office, technology, everything, and say, this is how we help you drive revenues, improve your schools, improve your performance, and bring innovative programs to your district. And that appeals to a district superintendent today because they are business people now. So those are kind of some common themes. I want to talk specifically, besides school safety, about the big bets. Career and technical education, CTE. High skill, high wage. This is what I refer to as a safe area in education today. The teachers' unions, they like it. Governors like it because it doesn't upset teachers. And we have very appropriately and correctly moved away from this idea that all kids had to go to college. Frankly, between 2009 and 2013, there was this, if not directly spoken, strongly implied belief that all kids had to go to kind of go to college. And we've now gone back to the idea that a well-trained workforce drives our economy. And so CTE is a huge bet. And if you are in the space today of being able to allow private schools, charter schools, public school districts of offering virtual CTE programming, so their kids aren't captured by an archaic schedule of having to go to their career and tech ed center for half day, having to stay in their home school for half day, if you help school districts solve that, that's a big win for you. Should be thinking about that. CTE is a big, plus it's built into most states' accountability systems. Get a kid a certification, school grade goes up. School grade goes up, what do you get to do? You get to promote your schools more. You promote your schools more, you get more kids in, you have more money. Project-based learning. I mentioned New Tech. New Tech is Knowledge Works, big project-based learning curriculum, model, I should say. And it really does answer employers' needs about how kids should be working in the 21st century. We used to refer to those, as you know, as soft skills. Don't ever do it anymore. There's nothing soft about them. Internships. Early college and dual credit opportunities, massive. We have a charter school in Gary, Indiana, of all places, that promotes the fact, and if you've ever been to Gary, Indiana, you've probably never gone back. He actually promotes the fact that about two-thirds of his kids walk across the stage in the charter school with a legitimate associate's degree from our state's community college. And don't think that doesn't get him a lot of kids. Again, if you can do that virtually, if you can do that through the use of technology, and you can help schools solve that so that kids don't get buried in their school schedules, big opportunity. Assessments. Who was it said teaching to the test earlier? Who was it? Teaching to the test. We are now looking at formative assessments and the platforms you can put them on. There is going to be a strong push over the next 3 years to allow states to look at rolling up formative assessments into a summative assessment score for a school grade. That was actually, believe it or not, folks, that was the original design of PARC, which was one of the two assessment consortia out of Race to the Top, was three through year assessments, and that would roll up into a summative assessment, but it was too expensive in 2010 and 11. 10 years later, it's not too expensive. And I think if you can help school districts solve that, because I think what you're going to see are RFPs out of states that say, here is a list of assessments you can use. Here are the requirements for these assessments. Use which one works for you. And then you have to decide how it works on your platform. So big play there. I mentioned choice and virtual education in districts. The last thing is, how do you solve the educator shortage? I don't know if you can do that, but think about this. There are some really strong alt-ed programs, alt-cert programs across the country. They are now targeting paraprofessionals in districts. How neat would it be if you could sell a technology solution as a partnership with Teachers of Tomorrow, iTeach, ABCTE, and allow a paraprofessional as they're in their planning period or off periods in the school district to sit down with a laptop that is provided to them either through the certification partner or the district to work on their teacher certification while they're sitting there in their district. Big opportunity there. Grow your own. School districts are very big about that right now. So I think there are some big bets and big themes that you can sell into as you look at what the environment was 10 years ago, the remnants of it still are today in education and still existing. Again, if I'm sitting here with you today and I'm gonna tell my guy here from Indiana, if you wanna go sell into the private schools. Go sell into the Catholic schools. Go sell into the Lutheran schools. Go sell into the independent Christian schools. You know why? They're competing with the public schools for kids. Now, we have a very strange dynamic in Indiana is that we have more kids in private schools on vouchers than we do in charter schools. That's a real anomaly. But if you're in a state with a large, like a Florida, that has a huge population of charter schools, I'd be doing the same thing in charter schools. Help them solve those problems. And believe it or not, there are education companies that do that with private schools and charter schools, and they still have robust businesses in public schools. There was a period of time between 9 and 13, if you were serving the private and the public school, the public, private and charter school community, public schools wouldn't deal with you. They froze you out. It's not the case anymore. It's not the case anymore. As a matter of fact, in many states now, they all just kind of join the same educational consortium. So we have about 20 to 25 minutes, and I promised Brent I was going to spend that time asking questions and engaging in discussion, because this presentation is not a business building presentation. I wanted it to provoke thought as you looked at the history of what happened and what's going on today as to how you can start capitalizing off of it. That's really the conversation I want to have. So with that, I'm going to ask you, off your index cards, off the top of your head, off anything I said, let's kind of have a freewheeling discussion here for the next 15 or 20 minutes about how does this policy environment affect your business? How can it affect your business? How could I see it affecting your business? Because again, as Brent mentioned, I do have a pretty unique view. I worked in a classroom. I worked at the building as an assistant principal, worked as a district superintendent, and I worked as state superintendent. And then prior to going with K-12, I actually represented business clients in state and district transactions all over America. So any questions you may have, if I don't have the answer, I promise you this, I have some very good partners, former partners, that I will get the answer for you if you want to email me, and if it's specific to a state and we have someone working in that state, I'll be happy to get you that information. So fire away.
So not Indiana specific, but where do you see superintendents prioritizing their budget spend, given everything going on?
Sure. First of all, I'm going to directly answer that, but I want to bring up something as well that you and I were talking about. It's a great question because, what's your name, sir?
John.
John asked a question, and he used a very specific term, superintendents. And you guys have to, I hope you know, that the guy you talked to today, or the lady you talked to today, in 2.7 years will likely not be there. So I think your biggest challenge is how do you develop a solution to someone who is in the office today who will likely not be in the office 3 years from now, and whose successor, part of their sustainability plan, is to talk about all the bad things that the person before them did. How do you make sure your solution holds a high enough priority here and here to continue to be implemented over a longer period of time? So, John, I just want to throw that out there. I think we always should be kind of trying to think about that, because that's the reality of the superintendency, especially in communities that have elected school boards. But John's asked a very specific question about where do superintendents spend their money? And I'm going to tell you, one is safety. Right now, if I'm a school district superintendent, the thought of some of the things that go on, and I'm not talking about active shooters, folks. I'm talking about non-custodial parents at the elementary school coming and taking a child that is they don't have a custodial responsibility for. I'm all the things that are unimaginable when most of us grew up. If I'm a superintendent today, that's the stuff that's keeping me up at night. Because that the last thing I can afford is to see my school district and my name on the front page of the paper saying I screwed this up and this cost a child being taken across state lines with a crazy non-custodial parent. You don't want that. So I would say, John, one is safety. And I don't know if you have safety in your quiver, but if you don't, you should probably find it. The other thing I want to talk about is if I am a superintendent today, I'm going to look at how I can spend money to make money. Okay? When I was a district superintendent in 2007, we did not live by anything called ROI. Today's superintendent has to. So I want to build innovative solutions for my districts, innovative curricular offerings, innovative instructional models that I can promote to drive greater revenue to my district, maybe get federal reimbursement, maybe get a state grant, or get more kids and drive my state revenues up on a per pupil basis. So I'm really going to be looking at those things like CTE, dual credit, especially in the virtual space. I would also suggest to you, how do you set up blended programs for districts? Because the dirty little secret is there is still this struggle nationally with pure virtual in the K-12 spectrum. Okay, we just, there for a myriad of all, some of very good reasons, some not so good, we're still struggling with that. But blended learning is a very innovative way for a school district to educate children and attract children. Yes, sir.
From a blended learning perspective, we're talking about creating a virtual classroom environment.
Mm-hmm.
My question to you is, if we have a virtual classroom environment, does that restrict the district on receiving cash benefits for that student body? Because that student body is not in that seat, would the district receive compensation for that student while they're at home in their virtual classroom environment?
So let me answer that directly. Yes, in a lot of states. No, in other states. What your question goes directly to a state policy initiative. So in Indiana and in Florida and in Nevada, Louisiana, Arizona, North Carolina, I can open a virtual school in Raleigh-Durham, Baton Rouge, Reno, and take kids from all over those respective states and be compensated by the state for them. Other states are more restrictive in that they still require a couple years ago, Florida just moved from the virtual programs only could capture kids in that district. And they just passed legislation a couple years ago that actually opened the borders, if you will, around the district to take kids from outside the district, even though they weren't sitting in a school. So yes. Now, there are some nuances, because some states only fund on completion. So you don't get funded unless the kid successfully completes the course, no matter where they're from. And we all know that part of the problem with the virtual is there's a little bit of churn in those kids. So the answer to your question is yes. And that goes to the issue. Remember I said talking about your state place? I don't know how many of you use, and I'm not promoting this for my benefit, don't know how many of you have used a state, I don't want to use the word lobbyist because I never registered as a lobbyist. There's a very creative way around it. But I don't know if you've ever used a client representative who has really good roots in a state agency. It's a good investment, because they can help you navigate some of these policy questions. They can help you navigate some of the state procurement processes, and they can get you into a Department of Ed who would say, oh yeah, if you want to do that, we'll tell the district they can do that. So those folks are very, very valuable to you and can really help you in terms of finding ways to get yes to things you want to do in local districts. Because by the way, what's the most common answer a district uses if you take them something really innovative? The state won't let me do it. State won't let me do it. So those folks become very valuable because they can get you to yes pretty quickly. So John, does that answer your question? What else? What are issues you're having? What are problems you have dealing with districts? Let's talk about that. Tell me what your, the beautiful thing, I was a district superintendent, I was your problem. What are the problems you have dealing with the folks you deal with in districts? Yes?
So we have, we just kind of got a film for safety, so we have that, but we mainly are in consumables.
Uh-huh.
So how does the procurement of office supplies, Janssen, toner, ink, how does that happen?
Great question. Again, very state specific. So what state are you in?
Colorado.
So I am not sure if Colorado has these or not. I know New York does, I know Florida does. I know we do in Indiana, I know they do in Kentucky. Does your state have educational consortia, ESCs, educational service centers? If your state has an educational service center, you should go to that educational service center and you should try to get on their approved list that goes to districts. Because here's the dirty little secret that ESCs have solved all across the country in states that have them. ESCs have already bid the products, and they already pass the state procurement requirements, so that a school district, if they want to go out and buy 60 reams of paper, 60 cases of paper, They don't have to put out anything on that. They go to the ESC, the ESC sells it to them because the ESC already has the state-approved procurement process. So if you can become part of that, for instance, if I had any product, I would immediately go to the ESC, and there are some who have these, some who don't. There are ESCs that specialize in e-procurement. And if you can get on the e-procurement list for that ESC generally sells to every state, every school district in the state, and your product is then in the face of everyone in that state, of every purchasing person in that state, in a manner that's already been approved by the state you're in. Does that help? ESCs are great tools. There are ESCs across the country that sell literally turf for football and baseball fields, lights, salt for the roads, school buses, technology, everything, and they do it. School district never has to do anything. It just gets on the computer. It's already integrated into their business software. All the POs are already generated. It goes through the district approval process, and it's all done, and it will pass any audit in most states where they're already set up. So So I would definitely go and find out, do you have access to an ESC in your state? What else keeps you up at night dealing with schools?
But it was all around welding and, you know, machines and all that. And then you start asking them about 3D printing and technology, and they go to the audio video group, which is also part of CTE, and they're running PCs that they're still getting refurbished from the prison.
Right.
Right. And how do you get them to change their priorities of not just focusing on the welding and all that and looking at utilizing more technology and
So it's a great question, and I would probably tell you, here's the way a superintendent does it. They put the pressure from the community. So when I wanted to do something that I was struggling to either get my board or get some members of our staff to buy into, I would go to the community and say, I'd go to the Chamber of Commerce and say, what do you think of this? Is this what we need to drive economic development in our community? And if they said yes, I'd say, would you come to a school board meeting and talk about that? So I think you are now in I know you're in that government solutions. You're going to have to think larger than, I'm going to talk to the district. What you got to say to the district, because look, how many people in here used to work in school districts? Okay, I'll probably irritate the five or six of you when I'm about to say this. I was one of these people, so I can say it. The one thing I have learned about school district people is they are a little bit intellectually lazy about this stuff. Like, when I was a district superintendent, if you brought me a solution and I had to do very damn little to get it done and it was good for kids, I'm in. And I'd find every way possible to box our board into buying it, just as long as it didn't take a lot of my time and effort. So my question to you is, how can you structure your business to be attractive to someone who either doesn't have the time, energy, or desire to take the lead on the project? For instance, CTE, all CTE by federal law have to have these craft advisory committees. They are a requirement under the Perkins Act. I would do a little investigation and see who's on those craft advisory committees, maybe make a couple contacts with a few of those members and say, hey, have you guys thought about this? Have you seen what we're doing? Our kids are behind. They're not able to go out and use this and get a high skill, high wage job, because the craft advisory committee by law is responsible for making those recommendations to their CTE center. But also go back that if I'm a district superintendent today, I don't want to lose my kids to the CTE center. One, I have to pay for them to go there. They'll go there a half day, it's going to cost me a half of a student count. So if I'm getting $6,500, I'm giving you $6,250 at least to the CTE center to educate that kid for a half day. Why wouldn't I develop my own in-house virtual or blended CTE programs so I keep my kids, I keep my $6,500, and I might attract other kids who do the same?
That's actually what this school district did. So it's actually on campus and they're doing it in there. So what's happened is it's blended and they go back and forth.
Exactly.
So what they're actually doing is they actually said, we want as many kids in the CTE program as possible because the state gives us more funds.
Bingo.
Than regular. So they're actually pushing it, the headcount, to get that. But they're still lagging on looking at the full picture of
so,
how it integrates.
The other thing you also want to do is, look, they're all going to get Perkins dollars. They're all getting these, as you said, additional pupil count monies. Talk to them about how they spend those. The more you get, the more you have. Great point, though. CTE is a big deal today. Micro-credentialing for kids is a big deal. You know, some states even give the CTE credit. The certification credit if you have a Microsoft Office credential. That satisfies whether your school's an A, B, C, D, or F, that gives you more points toward that A grade. It's not just getting an AWS certificate in welding.
No, they hang it on the wall.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
It's in the hall. They have all the certificates on the wall.
Absolutely. Oh, you know, it amazed me. To go back, it's really kind of funny. When we did this stuff here and we graded schools A through F, the superintendents across the state, like, they threw a fit. I mean, literally, oh my God. I said, well, you grade kids A through F. Why in the hell can't we grade you A through F? If it's inhumane to do to a kid, why is it, you know? And it amazed me that all the guys and ladies who complained about it, they were the first to hang those A's they got out on a, they had big banners, several hundred dollars they spent. This school is an A school by the Indiana Department of Education. And I saw one of them in a Kroger one day, and I said, I thought you didn't like that. He goes, well, I didn't until I got an A. So, yeah, again, it's marketing. It's marketing, yeah.
Where do you see STEM and STEAM in the innovation transition for schools and in this business?
So, it's really interesting. STEM, first of all, I'm a big fan of Project Lead the Way. So if you've not investigated PLTW, you should. It's a great program. It's expensive as hell, but it's a great program. But it is probably the ultimate STEM program in the country right now. I always kind of joke. I am much more like bullish on STEM. You know, we invested in the Woodrow Wilson Fellows to get more chemistry and physics teachers. We invested in Project Lead the Way. We invested in new tech. I'm probably more about that than I was adding the A to it. And that actually, to me, is your district. You know, now some state superintendents and state boards of education will pick that up, but I think that's a nuance. STEM is the rule of the day. Look, just know STEM is the rule of the day. And if you can find great STEM solutions that you can implement that, again, set school districts apart, I use Project Lead the Way as a good example. I sound like I'm paid for promoting them. I'm not. I just love that. It's an amazing, amazing program. If you see it, your kids, and by the way, they're even now developing an entire set of assessments that some of the elite Ivy League universities are agreeing to take in place of SAT and ACT. Yes, sir.
So you as a superintendent, if I came to you, your board, and said, we have a solution that can cover shrinking enrollment, make your district a destination district, UCTE, and it's called eSports.
Uh-huh.
What would you say?
So, you know, it's really interesting. Because I'm going to tell you, as a superintendent, that's a hard sell for me.
That's what I'm asking you.
And it's a hard sell for me because I came up in a very different way. I mentioned my background, and I'm so glad you asked the question because of my background. I coached in the largest state school in the state of Indiana that didn't play football. So Friday and Saturday night, in Scottsburg, Indiana, I was the community's social activity. And I would tell you today that in many places, the community aspect of schooling is the fabric of that community. So the answer to your question for me would be this: how do we use this vehicle to build community in our schools? I'm going to ask you that. And I'm always going to come back to that, because I will tell you, when I was hired in 1991 to coach basketball at Scottsburg High School, the school board president looked at me and he said, Tony Bennett, your job is to do two things. It's to win, and it's to put people in the stands. And if you fail to do either one of those two things, the next time we have these things called interviews, you're not invited. So, but that became our community. Friday and Saturday night was like Friday Night Lights. So I'm going to ask you, How can you build, and I'm not saying you can't, I'm saying you've got to prove to a superintendent, because most superintendents still came up through the ranks as either a coach or a band director. Okay? How do you convince them that we're going to build a community with this? Does that make sense?
That's easy.
If you can do that, you had me at hello. I don't want to lose my community, because my community is how I get support for my schools, and when my school board turns against me, it's how I keep my job. I have enough people come to a school board member and say, hey, he's a pretty good guy. We don't want to lose him. It's a great question. Great question. What else? We've got about 2 minutes, I think. Right, Brent? Yes, sir. So I am going to tell you that most superintendents I know will tell you, I don't care if the instrument I'm using will last. We care more about the durability of the instrument than the usability of the platform. Because you know what, I got an iPhone and I can run all my Google stuff off the iPhone now. It all seems to play reasonably well together. But I'm going to tell you that Windows versus Chrome is less important to me than is a Chromebook or a Surface or a MacBook or an iPad. Which of those will last the longest, be the easiest to service, the easiest to replace, and who do I get the best deal with? I can train the teachers to do anything else. And as a matter of fact, if I give them one of those new devices, hell, they'll all go to training for nothing. So I really kind of think about it like that. And I know that's probably not the answer you wanted, but for me, it's all about the durability of the device and how long it will last. Because again, I want to use it. I want to send it to the prison and have them refurbish it and be able to use it 10 years from now. Anything else? So I hope this has been helpful, this kind of stroll down memory lane. My email address, drtonybennett@gmail.com. Or tbennett@k12.com. That's my direct cell phone number. I never hesitate to put those up, because if you happen to Google me, you'll see some really unflattering things about email. And that's the same email address I used then, so I figured, hell, everybody in the world's got it. I may as well use it. So don't hesitate if you have a question. If you're working in a state and you're looking for a good representative in that state, I've dealt with most of them. I can point you in the right direction. If you want an introduction to a state chief, and I happen to know that state chief, I'm getting to know fewer and fewer of them, because the people who have a shorter tenure than district superintendents are now state education commissioners. You just don't have a very long shelf life in that job. But if I know them, I'll be happy to help you however I can. Again, thank you for your time. Thank you for your attention. Thank you for your questions. And Brent, thank you for the invitation. Thank you very much.